I love how so many areas feel unique but also realistic in Paldea. Like, I feel like this is a habitat that I could have actually worked in being a biologist. And this is Socarrat Trail. So let's look at what a Pokemon food web would look like in this area of Pokemon Scarlet and Violet. Socarrat Trail is found in the northwest region of Paldea near Castle Royal Lake. This is a habitat dominated by pines with a mix of sandy soils and rocky outcrops, much like the maritime and Aleppo pine forests of the Iberian Peninsula, the real-world basis for much of Paldea. This habitat has large trees and sparse undergrowth and experiences frequent wildfires, which is why you often find areas of burnt grass while exploring this area, and it's supported by its name, Socarrat, which is the toasted layer of rice at the bottom of a paella. That rice is toasted from the fire, and so are these plants. These grasses, trees, and other plants adapted to fires are often called pyrophilic, which means fire-loving. They, along with a few Pokemon, form our producers and kick off our food web. Pokemon in this trophic level are grass types like the Serena and Lurantis lines. They are able to photosynthesize like plants and likely get some or most of their energy this way. Our second trophic level is formed by organisms that eat producers, usually called herbivores. A lot of our biomass here is going to be made of invertebrates like our other food webs, and include things like insects. A Pokemon that fits here is Heracross, which may also prey on Bounsweet, which gets complicated because if you eat a plant-like Pokemon, are you still just an herbivore? Deerling and Sawsbuck also fit in this trophic level, but like the other grass types we mentioned, they may be able to supplement some of their energy needs with photosynthesis through the plants on their antlers. We also have the Slaking line eating a variety of plant materials to maintain their large body sizes, as well as Pichu, Pikachu, and Raichu feeding mostly on seeds and fruits. A surprising addition to this trophic level is Fortress. Along with its pre-evolution Pineco, they are mostly insectivores. However, when it evolves, it becomes a steel type. And where would this Pokemon get enough iron to completely encase its body in steel? How about the trees that Fortress and Pineco are so fond of attaching themselves to? Along with being our first predator of this food web, I think that Fortress is also a parasite of the trees that it hangs in. Iron is important for the production of chlorophyll, the pigment that allows plants to photosynthesize. I think that some of the strange funnel-like openings on Fortress are actually to siphon out of the trees in order to form its new metal shell. Insects also contain some iron and may actually be a pretty good source of a couple different nutrients according to this paper published in Food Science of Animal Resources. We need some more data on this subject as Pokemon scientists are understaffed and not many researchers are trying to get nutrients out of flies and flying beetles. Other predators, or secondary consumers, in this food web include Lurantis and Fomantis that are known to target bug types and likely insects. And another example are Stunky and Skuntank being a good example of omnivores, or organisms that eat both plants and animals. Bramblin and Bramblegast, as well as Bonsly and Sudowoodo, could be targeting some stray bug types or various insects found here. Sudowoodo's rock type would give them a type advantage against their prey, and might help explain why they camouflage themselves as trees. To help get the jump on insects and bug types, it might be looking for some nice vegetation to eat. And Bramblegast might be a grass type, but its Pokedex alludes to its predatory nature, and its ghost typing allows it to feed off of the life energy of its victims. Another set of insectivores, like the ones we just covered, are Shrutle and Grafaii, with Grafaii possibly targeting burrowing insects using its long, sticky, creepy fingers, like a real-world eye-eye that got into a pack of gushers. As well as Tarantula filter feeding for flying insects, and Spidops stalking a variety of prey before ambushing them and wrapping them up in its webs. Some more predatory Pokemon, but these are feeding mostly on our smaller mammalian-like Pokemon, are going to include Leafeon and Jolteon, who are solitary predators hunting smaller prey similar to modern-day foxes, and likely caring for some Eevees that are also eating a similar kind of diet. Their typing may be beneficial for resisting electric-type attacks from their primary prey organisms on this route, which are Pichu and Pikachu. This may also explain why the other Eeveelutions are missing from Socarrat Trail. It might be easier to deter a Flareon with Thunderbolts than a Jolteon or Leafeon that resists those attacks, so these two Pokemon are going to be more successful in this area, hunting these kinds of Pokemon. With a similar hunting style but moving up in weight, we have Zoroark. This is another solitary hunter, but its increased size and stealth abilities might allow it to take larger prey items such as Sawsbuck and maybe opportunistically some Raichu. Also selecting for these larger prey, we have Mastiff and Mabastiff. Their pack hunting abilities make up for their intermediate size and speed stats, and allow them to be a dominant predator on Socarrat Trail. One other final apex predator of this region is Toadscruel. Toadscruel is a large generalist that is going to ambush basically any Pokemon that is small enough or weak enough to defeat. Its ability to incapacitate its opponent through moves like Spore make it incredibly dangerous for most organisms to get too close. It's primarily feeding on Pichu and Pikachu, as well as Shrewdle, Pokemon that could occur in high densities in their habitat. But it probably wraps up just about anything it can get its little noodly arms on. More data is needed to see if grass typing allows Deerling and Saw's Buck to avoid predation, so we currently don't know about that interaction. Toadscruel may be a top-level predator, but its pre-evolution Toadscruel feeds on decaying plant material and is our transition into the last trophic level of our food web, which is our Detritivores. This grouping of Pokemon help break down organic matter and are important for nutrient recycling and are sometimes referred to as scavengers depending on their feeding habits. Both Toadscruel and Toadscruel have the ability Mycelium Mite. Mycelium is basically like a root structure but for a fungus. It allows fungi to absorb nutrients from their environment, and many plants have even evolved symbiotic relationships with fungi because of their mycelia and aid in the plant's nutrient intake, growth, and overall health. It seems that Toadscruel and Toadscruel are doing something similar. They can often be found at the base of trees in Socarrat Trail, which may suggest that they have a symbiotic relationship with these trees. Maybe Toadscruel helps break down decaying material in the soil, which provides nutrients for the tree, and in turn the tree is able to provide sugars to the Toadscruel, as is done in various real-world fungi. A similar relationship may exist with Fungus and Amoongus, however. Maybe they have a symbiotic relationship with other species to avoid competition with Toadscruel. We also have Murkrow and Honchkrow filling in as Detritivores on Socarrat Trail. These are pretty flexible Pokemon that could theoretically fill a number of different niches, but I thought being a scavenger really fit their bill of being a spooky Pokemon that people don't like to have around, as Detritivores often get a bad reputation, even if it's undeserved. Like, just because they want to eat a decaying carcass doesn't mean they aren't worthy of love. And if you loved this video, let me know what you think of this Pokemon food web, and if you want to check out more Pokemon food webs, check out this giant one on the Asado Desert, and happy researching.